Yo, it's Juan Youssef reporting live from New Orleans. Fellow Holly Grove native, very happy to see Wayne back in town. Very happy to see Wayne putting out new music. Can't wait to hear his opinions on the things that he just put out. We're all excited here in the city. Can't wait.
Hi, I'm so happy to have Tidal, and I'm so happy to be here to see Lil Wayne tonight. I can't wait to hear what he says, and I love the album. Thank you, Tidal.
I'm excited that Tidal came to New Orleans. We love y'all. Tune, we love you. C5. We couldn't wait for it to come out. It's beautiful. I hope y'all enjoy our town, our city. Tidal, love y'all.
Yes, Tidal, I bleeps with y'all for the crown. Wayne, Carter 5, it's love.
Hi, I'm a Tidal member, and I can't wait to see Lil Wayne tonight and see what he got to say about the new album, Carter 5. I get down for my crown.
Yeah, finally. How's everybody feel? New Orleans, make some noise. You get louder than that, you get louder than that. You know who's in the building? You know who's back there? You know how legendary this is? Yo, my name is Elliott Wilson, man. I'm from Crown, I'm from Tidal. We're live streaming this now. I'm so honored you guys came. This man insisted that we do in his hometown, New Orleans. You know what you mean to him? Make some noise for New Orleans in the building. And I know y'all got that Carter 5. I know y'all got that Carter 5. Was it worth the wait? Was it worth the wait? Yeah. You know it's worth the wait, man. I'm honored to this guy. This guy doesn't do a lot of interviews. I had the pleasure of interviewing him back in 2014. A lot's happened since then. He's got the music where it needs to be. He's got his business where it needs to be. And his legacy is always where it needs to be, man. He's obviously one of the greatest rappers of all time. I'm very excited that he took the time to speak with me. I'm very humbled and I'm very honored. I want you to make the loudest noise for the legend, Lil Wayne.
Work. I mean, I don't know what y'all came here to do, but if you ain't got a lighter, what the fuck you smoking for? You
what the fuck, though? Damn. Where the love go?
Uproar, baby. Like that one, uproar? A little viral
appreciate
sensation.
That. Thank you.
Lil Wayne, man. Welcome, brother. How are you?
I'm chilling. How you doing?
Let me get your mic, baby. How does it feel, man? Carter 5, man. Carter 5, finally out to the whole world, man. With the vision that you wanted, you know, you took your time, like you went through everything you had to get through to get to this point. You gotta be loving the reaction, man. Like you really were able to like deliver it your way, and it seems like it's really connecting to the people.
Yeah, before I say anything else, though, I must say thank you to every single soul in here. I appreciate it. There we go. I must also thank y'all for the support for the album. It was amazing. It is amazing. It's crazy. I had no idea to be this way. I thought I had a few people waiting for it to hear it. I didn't know I had the world waiting to hear it. I appreciate y'all. I
yeah,
swear to God.
Yeah. You doing numbers, Weezy. Like you always did numbers, but you doing numbers in this era. Like you like you're showing that like the appeal is still at the level it needs to be.
Yeah, well, yeah.
But what is it about? Here's the key, though. Like, I think when a lot of people first heard, okay, Carter 5, like, is this going to be an album? Is going to be old songs? Like, is it going to sound like today? But I know what you really did was you really tackled taking some songs that meant a lot to you and really updating them. Can you talk about that process of, like, making timeless music?
That was the thing. That was actually the thing. The thing was the music is almost 7 years old. And so it was almost like, you know, I even had to ask some of the artists, you know, are you okay with your verse? These people laid the verse down almost 4 years ago.
Man.
You know what I mean? So they had some songs on there. People were saying things. We were saying things in the songs that was going on at the time. We might have said a name or something to where if you hear it now, you'd be like, who? Who was that? What was that? So that was a big issue, the music and the era and the time.
But why?
So the way we handle that is the artists I chose to be on the album at that time, Even now, meaning I didn't have to change their verses. They didn't have to change their verses. And I didn't have to change any of mine. Maybe tapped around, switched a few lines, yeah. said a few things, turned they to the, it to of, those type of things. other than that, the answer to the issue was timeless lyrics, plain yeah. and simple.
Because, I mean, you talk about how you don't write things down and you go song to song. Like, yeah. what was it about these songs that felt like you didn't want to scrap the whole thing and just start from scratch? Like, why did you want to preserve that and get those songs out?
Again, I mean, given what you just said, I don't write anything down. I mean, I go in there and it's coming from me. And I mean, rather the people say that didn't come from the heart. That didn't come from it came from the person. It came from me. That's all of me, my heart, everything. So with that said, you can't change it because it's a picture of what you was going through and how you felt at that time. So if you change it, then now you're lying.
What are you most proud of about Quarter Five now that you, I mean, do you go back and listen to it? Like, now that you got it done, like, what are you most proud of it? And what do you think makes it unique? You haven't heard it?
I promise.
But what do you think makes this special in your catalog? Because, I mean, you've had a lot of great albums. Like, this is another one. Like, what makes this one unique and significant to your catalog?
Everything about it. Everything. The reality about it. The weight. The motivation, the, you know what I mean, the feelings, the love, the pain,
yeah,
everything about it, the people on it again, the artists involved in it, yeah. the producers, them having to wait, you yeah. know, they could have gave that music away, like, bro, yeah. I gave you a nice beat 5 years ago, you know, I mean, like, I could hear somebody else on that beat right now, but they stuck it out with me as well. So everybody who had anything to do with it, that's what means the most to yeah. me about that.
One producer you go real hard when you guys have a great chemistry, Swizz Beatz.
Yeah.
And it seems like that Uproar record is becoming its own sensation. Can you talk about like how that's become this viral, you know, challenge and like really has impacted people?
The thing is about a Swizz beat is it's the beauty after, because Swizz Beatz are so easy for me. Meaning he give them to me that day, I probably do the song. The song is probably finished the next day. I send it back to him for him to hear. He gonna do his thing to it. He gonna send it back to me. And it is what it is after that. So when he gave me Uproar, I did it that night. And I didn't expect it to be, I didn't even know if it was gonna go on the album, truthfully. Hmm. And when he sent it back with a hook, obviously that was just some lines in the verse. He flipped it and made it a hook. And he made it a song, basically.
Yeah.
And like I said, his beats, you know, boom, he gonna give it to you. You can't do nothing but spit on them. And thank God that's what I do. So yeah. it becomes easy.
Yeah. It seemed like even like you did the Pistol on My Side with him too. Like it seems like he also just, you guys connect on that energy, right?
Excuse me. Well, you know Swizz, Rough Rider days, DMX, you know Swizz.
Cash Money Rough Riders. Yeah,
exactly. You know Swizz been with the energy. So if Swizz gonna give you a beat, you better be ready. You know, you better be ready to go. And, you know, Swizz ain't about to give you one of them, you know, I want you to give me a nice hook on this beat. Or, you know, I can hear such a, nah, Swizz going to give you a knockout and you better knock him out back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What made you ride with it? Because I remember that freestyle Green Ranger with J. Cole, and you said you didn't like that beat. Then, ironically, you ended up killing that beat and making this hit record.
I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about. Sorry. No, I swear to God. Green Ranger?
Freestyle you did with J. Cole, one of the dedication freestyles. Is it Green Ranger? I'm not making it up, Weezy. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I don't. I work but a did little you hear way about, too but, much. I'm sorry.
But what do you know the original, the Special Delivery, the G-Dep? Were you a fan of that record?
Yeah. Special Delivery. Yeah, I know that.
Yeah.
I can only be honest, man. But shout out Cole. I don't remember the song, but that's my name.
Nah, but you even shot a visual now, right? So you're really going to push that record?
We shot it last night, actually.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you had the boy Shiggy in there? So you dance battling?
He crazy. No, we ain't battling. Ain't nobody can battle him. I ain't about to be battling. Yeah. He crazy. He turned it up. I thought it was just a special. I thought it was like one of Swiss nephews or something like that, that he wanted to get a shot in the video. So he was like, you know, next shot, I'm going to call you in. And so I was like, cool, I just know next when he called him in the shot, I'm gonna move to the right or to the left so the little homie could get his little nice little solo shot.
Yeah.
He called him in, homie's shoulders went to moving. I was like, whoa. Okay, I didn't know that's what he was about to come in here and do. So, you know, so it was a nice, it's nice little moment, nice video.
Yeah. Speaking of great collaborations, another one that's really resonated is that Mona Lisa.
Yeah.
You and Kendrick Lamar.
Song old, man. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. But why? Why do you, what is it about that? Like, it seemed like you said you about painting a picture, and it seems like you know. It seems like you may be speaking from some real experiences. Like, what is that? Where did that come from?
Again, I don't write anything down. When you write something down, you can tell a story. I mean, and you write it down, you can see what you can read over what you wrote and yay or nay it and put add this to it and add that to it to make it cooler.
Yeah.
When you come from here, you can't do nothing but tell the truth.
Yeah.
I mean, whether I was speaking truth or if it, that was a real situation or not, it's just facts.
Why did you decide to tackle that concept in that sense, to take that song in that direction? Do you remember?
The beat.
Yeah.
Yeah, the beat, and the beat brings whatever comes out of me on the song.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One thing that was cool, too, is including the brother Triple X, who passed away on the album.
Yeah.
Like, why was that important, like, to include him on the project?
That was Mac. That was my homie Mac, my big bro. That was his idea.
Mac May?
Yeah. Yeah, that was Mac's idea. He came to New Orleans probably. He came here to do something for, like, a day or two. He came back. He said, I have something I want you to hear. And that was my first time hearing my mom on the song. So when he played that, then he played the song, he was like, okay, you know, God rest, may he rest in peace. I didn't know, y'all know I don't listen to nothing else but myself because I work too much. So I didn't know who Triple Extension was. So Mac had to explain the whole story to me right then and there. I had to Google and all that, and I found out, figured everything out, and it was easy. It wasn't no such thing as yes or no. It was, let me get my verses together. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You mentioned your mom, like so much of your family's a centerpiece of the record, like including her so much. Like, did that develop even more than you originally thought it was gonna be in terms of using her so much on the album?
I haven't heard it. Okay.
But you had to have heard the intro. The intro is really.
That's all I heard. The intro to Don't. That what you guys. I think the way they put the album. I think you guys hit the end. I think that's the intro to the album, and then Don't Cry comes on after that. Well, the way it was presented to me was that was one song. So that's all I heard was her intro, and then Don't Cry came on. I did my verses. I was skating the other day. I plugged my phone up to the thing and put the album on.
Yeah.
And as I was skating, I could hear her talking more in the album. And I was like, wow, I didn't know she did that many songs of that. I didn't know she was on so much of the album. So I still didn't hear what she said yet.
Yeah. But that intro you did hear, like, is it tough to hear, like, the emotion in that, like, in terms of?
Yeah, because my mom don't get into that type of stuff, you know what I mean? So she ain't about to be crying and all that. So as soon as I heard her voice crack, I couldn't listen to too much more.
Yeah, no, definitely. You probably enjoy hearing your daughter, though. Originates on one of the records, Famous, like.
Who you think did it?
He said what? Say again.
Who you think put it together?
Of course. How did that come together? Like for your daughter to be on your record?
That's simple.
Why was it right, like this song and the right feel of it?
Again, that song was probably about 4 years old, bro. So she probably was about 15. When you can hear it in her voice, she probably was about 15 or 14 when she recorded that. Yeah. So at the time, Miss Betty Wright, the great Miss Betty Wright, she works with me a lot in Miami. And she was working with my daughter, and she helped on that idea, and that's how that came about.
Yeah.
And I got the verses together.
That's crazy. One of the most pivotal songs, obviously, is the last song, Let It All Work Out. Let It All Work Out. I mean, on that song, you know, we had always heard about a gun incident when you were a child. You know, you had shot yourself, and it seemed like with this song, there was a lot of speculation. It seemed like you brought real clarity to the situation. Can you talk about that?
That one right there, again, so about 5 years old. So, again, I was ready to bring it out then. These songs were recorded with the approach and the idea of, okay, this will come out probably next year, next 3 months or something. So I was ready to step out and talk about it then. And I was ready, you know, but God works in, people say mysterious, he works in his own ways. And it came out when it came out, and that's how it goes.
Yeah. But was it important to let people know that it wasn't an accident per se, that you were...
It wasn't about letting people know. It was about letting my mama know.
Say it again, I'm sorry.
It's about letting my mom know. It wasn't about letting people know and letting the listeners know.
Oh, she hadn't known until you made the record?
No, she hasn't known. We didn't sit down and talk about it. So the best way I can make it up is make it rhyme.
And it was a situation where you was upset because she didn't want you to rap?
To rap, man. I love rap, man. I died for it, bro.
I mean, you. This is like 12 years old.
12 years old.
And then what was it, just an argument or something? Like what led to?
No, I didn't talk to her. I didn't talk. She was at work.
Okay.
Yeah. She was at work. She didn't know anything was going on. She came home to the, well, she got off of work and had to go to the hospital.
Damn. So was it just a thing that you knew that she wasn't going to support you on that dream at first?
My mom was strict. She is still strict. And, you know, it was just, I'm very smart, thank God. And I was always, you know, in a good school and things like that. And, you know, you come from the places that we come from. So you got a smart son, a smart daughter, and they doing the right thing. Boy, you ain't about to be rapping. You know what I mean? You about to be somebody. You about to be a lawyer. You about to be a doctor or something. You too smart. Yeah. That's all it was. And I was more of, I am too smart. Can be a lawyer. I can be a doctor. But boy, if you let me be a rapper, I'm going to be a doctor, lawyer-ass rapper.
And if you remember, though, like, you dominated early, and you was able to, like, make your raps, and don't curse in your raps. That was the whole thing. Don't curse.
Don't curse. That's all she wanted, no cursing.
And then how were you able to spit, still be, like, young and spitting, like, hard bars, like, hardcore bars, and, like, was still with no cursing? Like, you definitely stood out. It's like, didn't hold you back.
It ain't, that's not what rap is about, cussing. Yeah, that's not about, that doesn't make the bar hard, cussing or anything like that. I think I proved that. Yeah, that doesn't make it, nah. I just started cussing when I felt like, okay, I don't think she's gonna trip now, so.
I think the big hardcore Cash Money fans love to see you back with Manny Fresh on the album.
Oh, that's big bro, yeah.
Yeah, let's start this shit right. And got the boy Mac Miller on there too. Like, how did that come together and what was it like reconnecting with Fresh?
Fresh, me and Fresh, I'm gonna say this a bunch of times. That song is about 16 years old, so.
These records are old, in case you don't know.
So with that said, it wasn't a reconnection or nothing like that, obviously. We've been connected, still connected. He's been still sending songs. I still do verses. That was just one we chose to put on the album. Yeah. I got probably about eight, nine, ten songs that y'all haven't heard that me and Fresh done. Yeah. We just chose those that we put on there. And I think we got denied for one. We didn't get the sample clear for one bar, but it's a dog.
What do you think of him? Like, what makes Manny such one of the all-time great producers?
Y'all, I need y'all to vote and beg for them to clear that sample so y'all
which
can
one?
Hear
which
that
one?
Song. You don't know, because they're not clearing the sample, so we can't put it out. But if they clear that sample, woof.
It's a hot one?
Yeah, man.
But you said you name dropped, had a funny line there where you said, tell them I've been rich since the Hot Boys days.
Yeah.
What made you say that?
I think it rhymed. just straight up, just because if anybody can attest to that, then it's Fresh. Yeah. You know, it's Manny. Manny know. What I meant by that too is I'm glad you asked about the statement. It was a strong line because obviously the facts are we wasn't being paid the way we were supposed to be being paid. So if I tell you to ask Fresh that I've been rich since the Hot Boys, I was just trying to tell them to ask Fresh. Y'all know I knew what to do with my money then, and I've been rich since then, and I know what to do with my money now. I went through a 7-year collapse, and I'm still here.
Yeah. Why was it tough for you also that it became so public? Like, you know, I know you keep things very personal. You like to be all about the music and not worry about the business.
Exactly.
Like, what was it like to carry that weight to have to deal with business on, like, a regular basis?
When you feel like you got to do what you got to do, it's not a job at all.
Yeah.
And you think about it after it's done. Yeah. So it wasn't, I didn't approach it like, man, I got to do 10 more things today, man. This is too difficult. No, I have to do these things to get back to where I need to be. Yeah. Plain and simple.
I mean, the perseverance of it is amazing. I remember there was a time, though, like I think 2016, you had teased about maybe quitting. Like, it was a tough time you were going through.
Very tough.
And someone like Kendrick came along and was just like, you ain't quitting. Like, those type of energy. Yeah. Like, people were so determined to lift you up.
Yeah.
Like, how important was that for you at that time?
Shout out K-Dot for love like that, man. But, you know, that's when you're going through things, like, and you go to thinking to yourself, you ask yourself, when you're looking around your living room, and you see Grammys, and you see plaques on the wall, and you see the house you're in, you look at your living room, you're looking at your driveway, and you look, you know what I mean, you know your kids are straight, you know everybody's fine, you know what you have in the savings or whatever, you know what you're working with, you know what you're sitting on,
yeah.
And you ask yourself, have you achieved everything that you, have you accomplished everything? Do you even, should you even still be wanting this? Or should you want something else? And should you chase something else? And the answer was, you should want more.
I'm willing to take the stand. Was that tough because of your ties with Birdman? I mean, he was a father figure to you. Was that tough for you to go through?
Business is tough, period.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why did you feel when he on Louisiana last time? I think he was in New Orleans. Your festival. Congrats on that again. It's always an amazing event, Louisiana. But Birdman came out and publicly apologized to you. How did that make you feel?
At the time, it was impossible to have any type of genuine or real feelings. I was on stage. I was in performance mode. I was trying to think about the words for the next song. I honestly. I was just trying to make sure he didn't say it at a time where it was my verse and I messed up a line or something like that. So that's all it really, and then somebody actually had to tell me, yeah. You know, he apologized to you on stage tonight. And I was like, me and him talked about it after.
Yeah.
It means a lot, but it's a personal feeling, yeah.
Yeah. So you guys still keep some sort of communication?
Of course, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a sports fanatic. I'm a sports fanatic. Even
so you talk about the Red
times,
Sox, right?
Even through the tough times, he gonna still text me about something about the game. Yeah.
So where do you stand now with Young Money? Like, so Young Money's all yours, right?
Yes.
You own everything.
Yes.
How does that affect like Nicki and Drake, for example? Are they still tied with you, or they're on their own thing?
They still have their own thing, and they're still with me as well. They've always had their own thing. Now it's just that they have the opportunity to let me make their own thing shine brighter than it has.
So you will continue to be involved in Nicki?
They're still my artists.
Huh?
They're still my artists.
Yeah. No, I'm just saying,
but they have their own things as well. And because now I'm in a position like I'm in now, I'm going to make sure whatever they want for themselves to be, and make sure it is exactly what it should be.
Absolutely. It was great to have Nicki on the album too. Like, how did that? I mean, I know it's probably an old song,
it's
Wayne.
Not. That
okay,
was
new
not,
one.
That's not. That was not. Yeah.
New song alert.
That was
Carter Five.
That was sent to me by Mac probably 2 or 3 days before the deadline.
Okay.
And he was like, you know, listen to this song, see if you like it, and I liked it.
So Nicki was like, I gotta get on that album. I ain't playing.
Yeah, it was her idea. She sent the song.
Yeah.
Yeah. So she killed it. So I had to kill it too.
Folks is disappointed Drake's not on the album, man.
He has a song that didn't get cleared, man. Y'all got them clearances, man. Them clearances, man. People be tripping when they find out who it is or when they find out what the song subject about. They be they don't want that to represent the names like that or something like that, you know.
Oh, it might have been a little more raunchy, the content?
They have their, you really don't know why they say no. You don't know. That's my opinion why they say no. You know, I'm going to think like that. I think it's because it's me. That's how I'm always thinking. Oh, you just don't want to do it because it's me. But the people probably don't even know who the damn song I'm trying to be clear by. So.
Yeah. What do you see? What did you see in those guys? I mean, the thing about, I know you don't listen to a lot of new artists, but obviously you're a heavy influence on a lot of their content.
By the way, too, as far as the Drake thing, a few of the singles we've released throughout the years, they were all Carter Five songs.
Yeah, those collabs.
We refused to let them wait. We refused to sit on them. Like, man, release them any kind of way
we can.
During
the Lil Wayne Drake tour thing.
Whatever,
right?
Believe Me, whatever songs. Anyway, even if there were songs maybe that went on his stuff or somebody else's features, these were all Carter Five songs that we just refused to sit on, man. Let's just put them out any kind of way we can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
People say, like, maybe because that's more kind of big tour, that Lil Wayne Drake versus Drake tour. That was ahead of his time.
Yeah, he a dog.
You think now that you got more of even a can of the hits, you think you might ever get a part two on that, on the tour?
Hopefully it's Drake versus Wayne versus Nicki versus such and such versus such and such. I'm trying to make the tree big, man.
Yeah. No, I was saying, like, you're viewed as sort of the blueprint of a lot of modern rap in terms of your influence on the newer generation.
Okay.
And out of that... You know, the biggest stars of the new generation are Drake and Nicki Minaj. Like, okay. So it seemed like you had that Midas touch. Like, what did you see in them? Like, what did you see in them? And are you even blown away about how big they continue to become as their own artists?
I'm not surprised at all. Not surprised at all. Nicki, what I saw in Nicki was definitely just something that she, I always knew that I knew more than she knew about herself, as far as talent wise. I knew that she was gonna find something that she didn't know she had, and she did. And as far as Drizzy always was just a knockout from the door. You know, it was just everything, plain and simple, when he was introduced to me. And I was like, okay, what does this kid do? Well, let me hear it again. And I was like, oh, who that is on the hook? I'm like, that's him too.
Yeah.
You know, you go to hearing the rap, like, he's spitting, you know what I'm like? And then when you go to hearing the hook, like, the hook, oh, who that is singing the hook? Yeah. Like, oh, that was him too.
Yeah.
And that's when I was like, that was him too? You know? And I was like, well, let me see the little homie. And when I saw him, you know what I mean? When I saw him, I was like, oh, okay. And I was like, where you from? Canada. Like, Canada? And it was like, he was also on a TV show when he was younger, so a few people may know him from that.
Degrassi, yeah.
I was like, what? I was like, well, he got a lot going for him, you know? And I was like, I'm honored for him to even choose me as an option. This kid could go, you know, is speaking in other terms, this kid don't have to sign with the Saints, he could go with the Patriots, you know, that type of thing.
Yeah. But what do you think, does it ever make you feel like, well, nah, I got to find, like, not cause, especially now because you're in control of your business, are you on a mission to try to find that next person, like the next young star that could be on the level of a Drake or Nicki?
I'm not on a mission to find them. It happens. It's called, I treat it like a needle in a haystack or a diamond in the rough. It happens. If it swings across my ear, it could be something smaller as a commercial, something I may get in my car to go to the studio or something, and those 5 seconds that I turned the key on and the radio was on before I pressed Bluetooth, my music come on.
Yeah.
Those 5-6 seconds, it could take something as small as that. Like, oh, what's this on the radio? You know what I mean? I go to phone call to Mac. Like, Mac, well, who is this saying such and such? He's like, oh, that's, I'm like, oh, they got a deal? Like, nah, that's a such and such rapper. Yeah. He just rap over the, Mac got to explain everything to me, y'all. I don't know nothing about social media, nothing. He have to, so he explain how they're not signed to a label, but they're big social media wise or whatever.
Yeah.
So that's how I'm like, get them to me, let me talk to them, and that's how it happens.
I mean, Mac, I love Mac Main. He's like one of your main guys, and it seems like his role in your career just seems to keep growing and growing.
Exactly.
He kind of let people know that don't know like how important he is to your career and exactly, you know, how deep your bond goes with him?
I explain this way. I have, from day one, I have never had a, I've never looked outside of my friends for anything of business or official-wise, meaning I've never looked for no manager that managed another artist. I've never looked for no assistant that assisted somebody else. So my managers has always been my best friends. My CEOs and my labor has always been my best friend. So to this day, Mac started by being a homie from being kicking it with me in school. His role went from that to being my assistant, meaning grabbing my bags. He did that too well. His role went from that to being over the assistants. He did that way too well. His role went from that to being over the artists, the other artists, Drake, the Nicki, you take care of their needs. Took care of that, they became who they became. Now Mac is my manager.
So he's your manager?
Yes.
Shout out to boy Mac May.
Yeah.
And you got him on to let him get on that record that Let's Start This Shit Right.
Oh yeah, yeah, definitely. That's the Manny Fresh joint as well, too.
Yeah,
yeah, we got Ashanti on there too.
Another great partner you have, and you kind of used a sample on the Dedicate record from the Colly Grove project you did with him, 2 Chainz.
Dedicate.
Yeah.
Oh man, if y'all watched Jimmy Fallon last night, I apologize. I did not know the words to that song.
You did flub it a little bit.
A little bit, boy. I told him, I said, yo, the first verse, I killed the first verse.
Yeah, you nailed it.
The second and third verse, you know, that was in Japanese and Vietnamese, and they didn't know that. So that's all that was. They didn't understand the words. It's cool. I killed it too in Japan and Vietnam.
But that sample's from the Colly Grove. Like, talk about, like, how important that project was at the time and, like, you know, the Colly Grove situation.
Let me tell you about that. That right there was just a brother, a big bro. And Tit, you know, y'all call him 2 Chainz, I call him Tit. That's just a big bro, just seeing, man, you don't have nothing going right now. You know, I have something going, as in, this is him speaking. I have something going. I have an outlet to where we can do an album together, and I don't know what your situation is to where they might want to block your money, might don't they want to touch your money before it gets to you for the album, but I know what it can do. It can boost the tour. And what happens is when you do any show, that's yours. And that was just a big bro helping me out.
Yeah, no, definitely. Yeah. Shout out 2 Chainz. Yeah. You was helping him out at that wedding, man. I saw you was helping him get his blazer together.
Yeah, man.
Classic shot.
He tall. Yeah. He tall, you need help.
But I heard Weezy was the best man, but you didn't have your speech together. They was like,
I ain't know I was supposed to give him no speech. They didn't tell me that part. Everybody was at, they said they asked me that too when I got there. They was like, you have your speech together. I was like, excuse me, like, what do you mean? And so they was like, you know, the best man gives, I was like, I'm sorry. You know, I've never been a part of no too many weddings unless it was my mom's or somebody in the family. And usually you just the ring bearer or something like that. You ain't gotta give no speeches and nothing like that. So that was all new to me, but now I know. Yeah.
Did you enjoy the wedding?
Oh man, one of the best things I've ever been to, did in my life, honestly. Honestly, it was totally awesome from front to end, totally awesome. I was happy for him, you know? It was dope. It was too cool, everything about it. The little things, the mishaps, everything was perfect.
Dope. Yeah. You also, speaking of opposite sex, man, you have some songs where you touch on certain things in relations with women and like a song like Mess.
Yeah.
How accurate is that?
I'm going to just go back to the point that I don't write. And so everything comes from me. That's how accurate that was.
I would say it's the same for Perfect Strangers.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, some of the lyrics be literally just conversations, making them rhyme. Have a good conversation with the song, have a conversation with the listener, and make it rhyme while you're doing it.
But I know, like, you are very proactive about your fatherhood and really taking that on, and your 4 children and FaceTiming your 4
monsters.
Kids.
Yeah.
Little monsters, man.
Yeah. That's my people.
How rewarding is fatherhood for you? Like, and does it make you want to feel like, well?
Fatherhood is everything. I wouldn't need a drop of any of this, 0% of any of this, any music, any rap, any of this, if all I have to be is the father to those 4, that is most the best thing ever.
So there may not be a Lil Wayne wedding in the future anytime soon.
I don't know. You done went Vietnam and Japanese on me. Oh, what you talking about?
I saw like a lot of times the album I thought was interesting too. That, and maybe this was Max doing. You use a lot of different, like Obama's speech mentioning you, Katie Couric, like all these symbolic things. Like, how cool is that when like you get mentioned like by these people in pop culture and sort of these like talk points?
Those are the ideas of the producer. Mm. Whatever song you hear the talking on and think that'd be the idea of the producer. Those songs are sent to me with that already in it. Okay. So that'd be the idea. It just be me to yes or no, go with it or not. And to understand what the producer, what his whole idea was to even put that in the song. I lay my verses down, send it back, and see if I fit the puzzle, and we did it right.
Yeah, so the reaction to Carter 5 is like, I saw some where you was like, you was teasing retirement before, but it's like, I saw some recently, he was like, I'm not retiring at all. Like, does this success of this album make you feel like you're just about to flood the market and have a whole new run of career? And like, are we gonna get like a
I did.
Another
I do.
Album?
I do. I feel like I've opened the door back up or whatever, if it was ever closed or it was cracked. I was in there doing something. Mind y'all been there. I didn't open the door back up. You know what I mean? Took the screen door off the door, and now I feel like I'm about to just be able to do whatever I can and make sure I do it right.
So does it feels like a weight off your shoulders?
I like the weight on my shoulders. I feel like I know how to handle it. Yeah, so, like I said, I feel like I've opened the door to now what? That. I like that. Now what? I like to answer that question. Yeah.
But do you think it's just a thing of like when an artist has such a long run of you that people try to get like, well, this is this person's best run, and they're always trying to find the ending of your thing? Like, so-and-so's not as sharp as he used to be, and just nitpick at things?
Oh, well, I've been doing it since 94. It's 2018. Yeah, if that's what they're saying about me, then I'm not worried about them. If they're saying it now, I'm straight. I'm good. That's there a little too late. Yeah. Despite, I think I proved that I'm timeless.
Is it strange to no longer have that Cash Money logo on a product and just not be Cash Money officially?
Not strange, because they, you know, it's Cash Money. It's, you know, it's not strange at all to see Cash Money and me and Lil Wayne. That's not strange at all. I think it'll be more strange if it wasn't. Yeah.
So it's almost like growth in a sense, right? Like,
say it again.
It's almost like growth in a sense. Like, now Young Money's allowed to really be, what you, in your viewpoint, yeah, exactly, its full potential as its own entity, standing on its own too.
Exactly. Yeah. And whoever comes, whatever artist comes along, or whatever artist is already there, they have their own thing. Yeah. They already know that I am the type of guy that is going to make sure your own thing is exactly what you want it to be as well.
How driven are you right now, like, in terms of, you said, like, they can't doubt you because of your legacy. Like, you know, you were saying best rapper alive a while back a lot. Like, is it important? How important is it for you to be viewed as the greatest at this point of your career?
Not important at all. Not important at all. It's important to be viewed as the greatest father by those four kids. Yeah. I don't think that matters.
Y'all can make noise for that, fatherhood. You ain't got to be all quiet. Can we break down the kids, like, four kids? Like, can you break them down? Names, the age, that's so we're clear?
Regine, she's 37. I have my oldest son, Dwayne Michael Carter III. He's 36. Now, he's about to be 10. You got Neil, that's my youngest. He's 9. And then you got Cam, he's 9 as well.
And he's still living in Miami, right? Like, I heard you got a whole new complex, a whole
I'm MIA. Yeah, I've been in MIA for over 10 years now.
How's that been? It feels like home?
Nah, it's home. I just love MIA. I just love it. Yeah. I went out there for a video shoot. I went out there for a video shoot over the weekend, and I never left. Nah, truthfully, that's how it went. I think we went out there to shoot. It was so long ago, bro. I think we went out there to either shoot Shine or something like Every Girl in the World. One of those videos we went out there to shoot over the weekend, and I didn't come back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you insisted we do this Crown in New Orleans right here where you're from. Like, about this city and like what it continues to mean to you. Like, what makes New Orleans unique and special to you?
New Orleans is unique, plain and simple. Without what it means to me is unique. Period. But what it means to me is home, plain and simple. It's changed a lot. It's changed a lot. I think it's changed for the better though. And I see a lot of diversity now. And you know, back then in my time. Lord have mercy, I feel old when I say that. Back then, in my time, I remember New Orleans, we all was on the same page. I mean, we always stuck to the same, we were all the same type of way. Now I see a lot of diversity when I'm riding in the car now, and that's beautiful.
Yeah, also has a very rich musical history.
Of course.
With jazz, it's almost like, I seen somebody say it online, it's like, and it's true, like, you got almost another point, like, you got to mention Lil Wayne in the groups with, like, the Louis Armstrongs and that
oh,
level.
No. No, don't do that. No.
No? Come on, Weezy.
Come on, man. No, I don't know if it's just me being humble or...
Yeah.
I don't know if I could put myself up there with Louis Armstrong and all that type of stuff. Nah, I think I leave it to somebody else to put me wherever they need to place me, whoever the official placer is.
Are there still people in hip hop you look to as above you, forefathers, or like people that paved the way for you that still inspire you?
Hell yeah. Yeah. Hell yeah. Some of them may not be around, but hell yeah, they're still my people. They're still who I believe is the dominant. That's still who I look for advice through their music. And sometimes, fortunately, I may have their number and I can call them and ask them.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're still a Jay-Z.
Say it again.
I said, there is still a Jay-Z.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Shout out Jay Jones. It's on title.
I haven't heard of him.
I heard there might be a Mr. Carter record floating around. Another Mr. Carter record, my man. See the light of day soon.
Yep, I sent him a record, but he was, he's busy. He's on tour with Wifey right now. Yeah. So, you know, so he couldn't meet the deadline, that's all.
Yeah. The Jay-Z collab also. Another OG that you know, you said Snoop Dogg. I was surprised to see him on the album.
Ooh, Snoop, an OG, man. Snoop came through. I sent that song to Snoop. Snoop probably banged that out in like a day or two. Sent that right back and with a FaceTime message like, what's next? Yeah, I swear. I was mad because I sent him the song. The way they sent the song to him, they sent it without the... I mean, basically, I wanted him to do the hook, but I ended up doing little ad-libs on the hook, just like, you know, I think gone out of broke, nigga. That was not the hook, so I think Snoop thought it over when I started saying, I grew up around dope, nigga. I was just saying that as ad-lib. He thought that was my... So he stopped this hook right there. It went all perfect. It went great. I was mad. I was like, man, why y'all sent the man the lyrics with that, man? Y'all should have sent the man just an instrumental. We probably just got about 16 bars, a hook, man. But he sent it back like, he sent the FaceTime when he sent the song back like, you know, that ain't enough. Huh? What's next? Send me something else. So y'all will be hearing some more.
Great. I wanted to ask you, that's funny you mentioned Jay. I asked Jay, give me one question I should ask Wayne. And I think a lot of people wonder, he wanted to know, like, what do you think some of your best verses are?
A Millie. To me, a Millie is always one of my best verses. And I don't know the name of the song, but it's Man, Fuck These Niggas. That one. That's one of my favorites. Yeah. I like to perform those songs when I perform. And I don't know if these are my favorite. I know I like to perform these songs. Yeah. I love performing the Millie. I love performing that, and I love performing. I'm going in.
I'm going in.
I love performing that.
Yeah. What was this? Millie exploded out the gate. Like, what are your memories of that record? Do you remember that session? Like, what made that special?
I just remember, you know, at that time I was still just I still am. Cut the beat on, tell them go. Yeah. And that's how that happened. That's why we shot the video like that. I just told him, bro, you know, let's just shoot the video of me getting dressed, getting ready to go to the set of the other video.
Yeah.
It was like, what? It was like, yeah, that's how the song felt to me. So let's shoot the video that way. Became one of the biggest things I did.
Absolutely. I mean, no one can dispute your contributions. I know the BET Awards, Hip Hop Awards coming up. I heard you getting the I Am Hip Hop Award. How does that make you feel?
Thank you.
Very well deserved. But it's funny, like, it could be like a legacy thing, but you're going to have the number one album in the country when you're out there on that stage. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's still going.
It's beautiful. Yeah. It's beautiful. It's just from the fans' point of view, I love, you know what I mean? I'm nothing without them. I tell them all the time. And so that's what I look at it as. And it's going to be definitely one of the most valued awards on my shelf.
Yeah. I remember when we did one of the XXL covers, you had an I Am Hip Hop. T-shirt and stuff like that. Like, you know, it was the anniversary of Outkast recently, and like they had that famous speech about the South got something to say. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, can you speak a little bit about that, like in terms of like, you know, being not outside of New York or LA, but your dedication to rap music and like really earning respect, you know, from the audience and from your peers?
Yeah.
Like, what was that process like for you?
It was about taking it on. Taking on with okay, this is what y'all, this from a young age as well too. Meaning, knowing that I'm about to go in the studio with my homies, or with my big bros and my father figures, all that. Juvie, Turk, BG, yeah. Stunner. I know what the conversation is about to be about. I know what the song is about to be about, and I know what I better talk about on this song. You know what I mean? It's about taking it on, though, knowing that even though we doing this though, I know what the world think hip hop is, though, and I know that they think we only rapping. So it was up to me to say, okay, after I do this, let me figure out what they doing over here, though. And so there will be some time that I'll be able to mesh them, put this and that together, and become who I am, and that's who I became, and I became hip hop.
No, definitely. And then, like, I remember the people see you embrace like movements like Dipset and really embrace
these. Oh, that's bros, things. Yeah.
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 We still waiting for that. I can't feel my face, man. We still waiting for that.
Man, shout out my bro, man. He going through a tough time right now. My bro, Juelz, he going through a real tough time right now. He can't even leave the crib to work right now. But shout out my all love, man. You know what it is. Hold your head.
That's dope, man. Congrats on everything, man. I think we might try to take a little questions, right? Want to open up and get a little questions?
Are we good, dude?
Open letter, though. I want open letter, though.
Yes.
That song seemed like you, at that time, you had a lot to get off your chest. Like,
yeah.
You know, why was that important to just, like...
I remember doing the song. I remember doing that song. Something very, very rare. I don't usually remember what I do when I'm doing a song, when I did a song. I remember the night. I remember the day, what I went through. I remember the conversations I had that day. So that was just a tough day. Just a tough day, some bad conversations. Some people made me feel like I wasn't, you know, wasn't shit like I said on the song.
Yeah.
And I had music to do at that night. That night, give me a beat and I let them know how I feel.
Absolutely, absolutely. It always resonates, man. It's powerful. It's powerful, man. And then one more thing, took his time. I remember Mac played me that, and I love that hook that Mama said.
Yeah.
Mama said God took his time when he made me.
Yeah.
That's powerful. Like,
appreciate
that. You remember how you came up with that line? And
it's a homegirl. It's a homegirl said, she told me, she said, you know, she was like, you know, God took, you know, just quote unquote, said God took his time when he made you. You know what I mean? I said, and quote unquote, I'm a rapper, man. I said, man, that's a hook. Yeah. So I then when I did a start thinking, I was like, you know, my mama used to tell me that. Like maybe not in those words, but she used to tell me the same thing. Not only my mom, but my grandmother too.
Yeah.
And so I said, so that's how that one came about.
Yeah.
Make it rhyme.
Back to your mom, it's funny, I feel like she kept saying a thing like, you know, everybody asks you about your album, it's coming. I know it's gonna be a beautiful album. A lot of pressure.
That's my love.
Yeah. 23 songs though, man. Why is the album so long, Wayne?
That's short.
Hour and a half?
That's short, bro. 23 songs is just a cutoff. I got about two albums that short. I have two other Carter Five albums that just Mac was even wanting to go with the idea of just, you know, doing a 40 song album, just giving them one album one day and a surprise album the next day. I was like, nah, we just give them what you can give them, and we'll just figure out the rest after that.
So is five the end, though? You're not going to sneak and do another one, a Carter six? Does the five feel like still the end of that series?
I still have to determine that, you know, because, again, I'm opening doors into moving into my own direction now. Mm. You won't be seeing that S logo on my music, on my albums too much longer, so I'm not
you
sure.
You won't see what logo?
You won't see that Cash Money logo on my music too much longer, so I'm not sure if I want to just end the Carter's thing with Cash Money and let that be what that was. If I want to continue, it's still a decision I need to make.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's important. It's important. All right, let's get a question here. Appreciate you guys coming out.
Whoa, over here, playboy.
What up, Slime?
Yo, man, my name T. Riley, a.k.a. Playboy Troy.
Bet.
A.K.A. Mr. Old Soul.
Believe that.
You got a lot of AKs.
Man. Well, look, man, I just want to let you know, I'm a rapper, and I actually look to you to be one of my GOATs. I want to know, give me a hint to keep going in music, because sometimes it get hard. You don't feel like you get the recognition you need.
Yep.
Well, where you get your motivation from, man, when you started?
My motivation comes simply from what satisfies myself. Never look for what satisfied the people, not even the person next to me, not even the engineer, not even the person in the studio with me, not the homies, none of that.
Yeah, yeah.
Man, I really
love.
Appreciate that. One
all
more
love.
Question.
All good.
I got my demo on me right now, Bill. What's up?
It's called Mac Mean. Mac Mean.
Can I go
Mac.
See him right now?
Mac.
Go see Mac?
Mac. Yeah, Mac got that.
Mac will play the next song. Let's go to the next question.
How you doing, sweetie?
Right here, my name, Nu.
How you doing, Nu?
I need you to bring the draw back that I like my seat down low. My window slightly cracked. Ryan with a bad hoe with a girlfriend in the back. I like to get real high and I never look back. Man, you don't want to try, man. Don't I look strapped? I come from the whole
never heard
city.
It in
ain't
my life.
She got to teach you the words.
Never heard of this in my life, but kill it. I love it. Was that me? That was me? Love.
Oh, we got a gentleman here. One second.
Hey, how are you?
How you doing?
back at Voodoo Fest, like 2008, 2011, you were doing Please Don't Shoot Me Down. And I swore as I watched, you were pantomiming pointing the pistol at yourself. You were holding the pistol like this and pointing it back. Were you already telling us that that wasn't an accident?
I probably, and you say it was at Voodoo Fest, I mean it was here, right?
Yeah.
I think I probably was. Anytime there's a festival, anytime there's anything here in New Orleans and I'm going on stage, I'm not approaching it with a work-like mentality. I'm approaching it with, it's from the heart, it's genuine, it's whatever happens out here happens. And so most likely I was.
Yeah. And back to that Let It All Hang Out, you said, Mac was telling me that a lot of also why you was willing to stay, because you almost felt like you want to put it out there, because you know there are kids that go through that sort of feeling that you went through and may get suicidal and may go through tough times. Like
conversation that me and Mac actually had, that Mac and I did have, I said, you know, didn't put it out at the time I wanted to put it out, but because it came out right now, I know that the world has become a crazier place and there is a lot of that happening. Yeah. And told him that, you know, not my goal, not what I'm trying to do, not trying to be the voice or something like that of the people, or trying to, but told him if I am needed to help because of it, I'm here.
Absolutely, make some noise for that, come on. Absolutely. Next question.
Yo, I'm BJ Wayne.
What up, bro?
My question is, you say you haven't really heard the Call to Five. Were you part of the process of picking the songs and the songs' orders, or was it Mac?
Mac. Yeah, it's Mac. What he does, though, is he pick them and he tells me his ideas for why he picked them and what he want to do, what he see videos, or why he think the song is needed. Little things like what he just asked. He know that Mac knew that a lot of people was, the young people was going through that same type of thing at the time. He was like, you know, I think this song need to finish the album out so the person, whoever, the listener could hear this at the end and make them think, and then it touched the soul. So it was all Mac, yes.
Yeah, shout out to Mac Main once again. Hello.
Hey, Wayne.
Hi.
I'm a DJ, and
Okay.
As a local creative, I want to know, because we have this renaissance of New Orleans artists just stepping up their game in a community and they work, everything like that. So I want to know, what advice do you have for our local artists to keep pushing it and being, you know, as great as you?
Thank you. That advice is plain and simple. Keep doing it. And always try to find something else. Always try to find something new, as in your music and your craft. Always try to find something new. And remember that you're doing something nobody else is doing. That's the main thing. Even for the homie Riley, just remember that I'm always doing something nobody, I'm saying something nobody else is saying. And rather, they're listening, not I am. And must always remember that they will one day if I'm saying what they need to hear.
Yeah, it's a process, man.
Wayne.
Yep.
Yo, hey, look, I'm an R&B singer from here. Look, you looking for any singers? I sing. I do everything. My name is Rocker B. I'm from the city. I represent the city just like you. You feel me? And my whole perspective on it, when I was to go in the studio, yeah, I was trying to kill it just like you kill it. Right. When you go and you knock it out, you dig?
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm going to give her a little something here if they want me to, huh?
We're going to send that to Mac Main. Mac Main is the plug.
Shout out, Mac. He posted me on his page, too. You hear me?
Oh, Mac G.
Holla
at Mac. But with that said, we don't have any R&B singers other than my man Drizzy. But, you know, he way more than R&B.
No, look. So, that, you know, like I said, if you need any singer, I'm going to holla at Mac. You already know. Shout out, Jay. You know what it is. Shout out to you, man. The GOAT all day, man. Get that Call to Five.
Speaking of R&B singers, it was very unique bringing Ashanti back on that joint. Like, how did that come together?
Song was done a million years ago. Ashanti just, you know, Ashanti also, actually, the song was originally sung by someone else, and Ashanti, we needed it to be done again, and Ashanti took over that, but that was still done years ago. So, I mean, you know, I'm still gonna put it out the way it go, and that's how it came out. So, yeah, Ashanti, that's the homegirl, though, you know.
Yeah.
Ashanti and been doing tours together for, we did tours, more than one or two tours together.
And your child's mother on there too? Nivea's on there?
Yeah, of course. Nivea sounded like an angel on there. I wouldn't dare replace her on that song. She sounded awesome on that song. Song about 18 years old, but she sounded awesome on that.
19 years old one.
Yeah.
Let's get two more questions.
Yo, what's up, man?
What up, bro? What up?
Hold up. Big fan. I grew up listening to you.
Appreciate that. Appreciate that.
My question is, looking back, you know, it was 14 years ago or something like that when everybody left Cash Money.
Mm-hmm.
Do you ever have any regrets not leaving Cash Money and probably signing to, no, you were supposed to sign to Rockefeller back then.
Mm-hmm.
Do you ever have any regrets not signing?
Oh, I have no regrets about nothing in life. Oh, no. Life is life. You accept it. You accept what the facts are. What the facts are, the truth is, the reality is, you accept it. You look yourself in the mirror and you embrace it and you go.
Absolutely, absolutely. Feels empowered.
Or not.
Whatever.
I got a rap question. Mm-hmm. You've been telling us that you freestyle a lot. Do you remember the last song you wrote or the era of it? Or like when you started freestyling, like what era was that?
The last song I wrote on paper was, I want to say it was a rest in peace song. It was for my dad's best friend. And I rapped that rap in front of his body at the funeral. I probably was about 13 years old or something like that. I wrapped it with the paper in hand, in front of the casket. Didn't think, I figured by being 13, I figured it wasn't gonna matter to me. I just wanna rap. I don't care if it's in a church, I don't know, whatever. Didn't think I was gonna have any emotions. Found out that day that I was a man at 13. I already know. Yeah, love, boy.
Let's do one more.
Hey, Wizzy.
How you doing?
I'm Asia. Nice to meet you.
Likewise.
My question is, you seem like you handle like adversity, you handle pain, you handle struggle, you handle all that really well.
Thank you.
Just seem like, you know, really just chill, calm, Gandhi almost, you know?
Jesus, so, thank you.
I wanted to ask, do you feel like, you know, everything you went through, do you feel like that made you who you are, but do you feel like you sacrificed a lot to be where you are, or would you like do it again?
Oh no, I would do it again in a finger snap. There's no sacrificing at all. If I start to feel like I'm sacrificing anything, then that means I'm doing it for myself. That means I'm putting myself above people. I mean, thinking I'm putting my neck out there for people. Nah, I'm doing it for us all. Yeah.
And we want you here, man. Like, you had some line about the white cup. People say it's a bad look. You never know when it's your last look.
Yeah.
But, you know, I've also heard like you're getting a lot more rest now, taking care of yourself. You're not like doing as many marathon sessions. Like, you talk about, like, you know, trying to make sure your health is better and where it needs to be?
Marathon sessions, first of all, meaning I used to work, a session for me probably would be almost 26 hours.
Wow. You know what I mean? So, that's a marathon win.
Yeah, so I broke that down to 12 hours. You know what I mean? So now if I go in there at 2 a.m., I'm making sure we're trying to wrap up by 2 p.m. So therefore, I can't go home. Whether it's rest or not, I'm still at home with a bunch of me time that I didn't have. You know what I mean? So I'm not sure if it's doing anything for the better or whatever, but I like the me time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know you're a sports guy. LeBron and the Lakers? What's your thoughts on that?
Oh, yeah. We're going to have fun. We're going to see. We don't know what's going on yet, but it's going to be fun. I know that much, yeah.
Well, best thing fun is that you're back, man. Carter 5.
Appreciate that, man. Thank
amazing
you.
Album.
Appreciate
congratulations.
That.
You did it your way.
Thank you.
And I'm expecting many more, man. Make some noise for Lil Wayne. Yeah.
Thank y'all again. Appreciate every single one of y'all. I swear to God. Thank you. Thank you. I apologize for the time I saw y'all down. I looked out the window and saw y'all waiting. I'm sorry, I told the homie, one of y'all, I said, man, give me 30 minutes after that. I apologize, but I appreciate it, man. Thank you.